I'm Cynthia James, and this network is about changing lives one woman at a time.
Hello, and welcome to Women Awakening. I'm your host, Cynthia James. And you know, I get so excited, giddy, in fact, that I get to introduce you to fabulous women. Women that inspire me, women that are change makers, women that are ordinary, just like you and me, who are doing extraordinary things and making a difference on this planet. And they're way showers. They're telling us they're not exceptions, that they're examples of what it looks like to be an empowered woman. So I'm so grateful that you're here. You know, we're on all the platforms, iTunes, iHeart, Spotify, Spreaker, Amazon, and a video on YouTube. You just look for Women Awakening, Cynthia James. And you can go to my website, cynthiajames.net. There's lots of stuff there to support you. I want you to know that you're coming here every week, guaranteed that you will walk away with nuggets every single time from every single woman, because they're inspired and they're motivated. They're healers and they're teachers. So I'm grateful that you're here. I'm grateful that I get to be with you. And please share the videos, ask other women to subscribe. We've interviewed over 200 women around the world, and it's just incredible. So my guest today is someone who's new to me, Cindy Dibete. She's a seasoned corporate governance strategist and accomplished non-executive director with a distinguished career that's forged over 22 years as a professional accountant. She specializes in architecting strategies that fortify organizational resilience. And she blends her financial acumen with what she calls entrepreneurial fervour. We will talk more about this, but she founded a foundation dedicated to facilitating divine conversations, an avenue for exploring unconventional discourse. Cindy, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you very much, Cynthia, for having me. I am so honored.
And where are you located?
I'm located in South Africa, Johannesburg, South Africa.
It's on my bucket list.
Yes, soon. So yeah, let's have this conversation. Let's see, maybe I may just persuade you to come visit us.
Well, I want to start with how you were born and how you grew up.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I grew up in a small, well, not so small, but very, very, very rural area called Guasati. See if you can say that.
Guasati?
Yeah. Close enough. It's not in the city at all. It's far from Johannesburg. That's where I was born. And I was born by two teenagers. My dad was 20. My mom was 17. So I was a product of teenage naughtiness. And that's where I grew up until age 13, when I came to the city. And then started my career around, say, age 22 or so. But out in the rural, I was herding cattle at some point. And most people don't believe that I used to herd cattle. And it's a pride point for me. I think it's a huge achievement. But yeah, I grew up in a very, very laid back, very home environment where, it's, you know, everybody knows everybody. And it's, you know, you are everyone's child. And I grew up in this community, you know, a sense of community. And we did things together. And there's no starvation. There's no poverty, because you can't really tell, because there's neighborliness, you know. Mm. And that's the environment I grew up in.
Well, don't you know what? Isn't that interesting? Because I think that that's what's missing in the world. We are loss of community and neighborhoods and connecting and taking care of each other and raising the children together. So I love that you did that. Were you always into finances or math? I mean, was that always a gift for you?
I was into curiosity and just fun. and just enjoying things. I mean, I remember, I think I must have been 10, 11, when I realized the interconnectedness in subjects. And I tried to have this conversation with somebody. And most of my friends did not really get it. And I just thought, oh, okay. So it was this little world I lived in inside of myself. Where I was like, oh, you know, you just have to listen really, really, really closely in class. And what you learn in one subject, you can use in another. And that's how you get through it. And it was fun for me. But I learned of accounting first time I had the word, I was 13. It was in a class and we had a guidance teacher who was taking us for that period. And he just mentioned, and he also didn't even understand what an accountant was, but he mentioned it in passing. And I heard it for the first time and I was like, I'm going to be one of those. And that's it. The rest of this day is history.
Okay, so tell me about the work that you do. Do you work with an organization? Do you work with different people? You know, what? Tell me what you do with people.
So I don't work with an organization as in corporate. So I'm not employed. The only employment I've ever had was doing articles, which was my apprenticeship. Mm-hmm. And after that, I started a firm, which was an accounting firm. And the reason that I went that route was because my passion is helping business builders make sense of the numbers. So accounting just is a byproduct of what I actually do. What I actually do is, why are you doing what you're doing? What sense does it make for you? You know, does it talk to your purpose and your vision and your being and your values as a person? Does it feed your soul? Why are you in the business that you are in? And then let's work together to build a business that is very, very tethered, which is not just about making the money, but making the life. Because we spend most of our work life in business and in work. So why do we need to be unhappy? So happiness is very important to me, and that's what I do. So all day long, I have these conversations with entrepreneurs. And I said, let's find people that can support your business and bolster it, so that you are able to work smartly and achieve your goals quicker, you know, in a smart and fun way. I mean, we really, really do not need to be miserable. I don't like being miserable.
Yes. Well, I love what you're saying. You know, I've done a lot of work with women entrepreneurs, and the money, the accounting, the numbers is the hardest thing for many of them. It scares them, and they're afraid to go into the conversation and do the learning. So I love that you've connected that to happiness and purpose and mission.
Yes. It actually can be fun to do business and look at the numbers. And that's where it starts, don't you find? We just 100%. Like don't really want to look, you know? Look at the numbers and let's draw a story from the numbers. And then design where we want to go, what kind of lifestyle we want to have using the numbers. So, it's a lot of fun.
It's so important. Anybody who's listened to this show for a while knows that when I first started my business and I got a coach, she wanted me to look at my numbers. And I almost had a meltdown because I had the belief, and I'm saying this for a reason, I had a belief that I wasn't good with numbers, but it wasn't true. And I just needed to learn the system.
That's it. I mean, even with the work that you do, how do you know that you're good at it? Because you learn, you put yourself through the process. And once you learn, then you become proficient. And then you are confident in it, then you do it. So it's the same with numbers.
100%. And so I can just tell by the way your face lights up when you talk about it that you love this. But I want to know, how did this work that you do feed into this thing called Divine Conversations? What is Divine Conversations?
So all in the spirit of finding happiness, if you will, but all in the spirit of being honest with ourselves. What I found then through coaching and learning coaching, because I employ a lot of coaching tools in my work, as one can appreciate, because it's not just about doing the accounting work. It's not just about doing the governance work, but it's bringing the person along with, and the coaching tools are brilliant for that. So then I discovered that more and more, there are stories that we keep. You know, we talk about self-sabotaging. We talk about all sorts of things that make us feel less than what we actually are. But if one now said it, even if you scratch just a little bit, you find that there's a story that is behind that. Now, Divine Conversations allows us a platform to take these stories, surface them, and let's have a conversation. So we've had, there was an era, and I'm not sure if I can safely say it is over, but there was an era in South Africa where we were seriously ravaged with gender-based violence, but in a huge way, in a very, very, very alarming way. It hurts. It's painful. There were so many deaths of, you know, females, people, women being killed just for being a woman. And most of these were happening in intimate relationships, right? And it wasn't my intention necessarily to respond to that, but just looking at the bigger picture, I could see that there are some conversations that we are not really having, even us as women. And we had, for instance, a conversation on polyamory, for instance. And the reason that we were having a conversation like that, it was to say, please note that there are other options of being in a relationship, right? And immediately it opens the lid on, oh yeah, the man can do whatever the man wants to do, and the woman will have to take it and accept it. But can we have a conversation to say, what kind of a relationship do we have? Right. And it was very interesting. I mean, that was one of the dynamic conversations we had, because we had polyamorous couples, or more than couple persons in the room, and we had monogamous persons in the room, and we had an honest and a candid conversation. By the end of that convo, there was a respect from the audience for the people that came in and thinking, what? You can actually be in a relationship with several people and it's open and judging the system. And by the end of the conversation, people were literally declaring that I didn't know what I didn't know. And I actually have a lot of respect for the kind of union that people have. So that is just one of the examples of the conversations that we have. We've had conversations around names and naming. Why are you named what you are? And what does it mean? And how does it carry your papers, and what do you make of it? So it's things like that, but we have them with the idea of saying, let's open our minds, let us unearth these conversations, things that are happening in our minds, and most of the times they are slowing us down in being the best that we can be. So that's how Divine Conversations was basically born.
So this is a vessel, a vehicle for educating and inviting people into conversations that might not be the norm.
Exactly. It's unconventional conversations, and we create a platform for it that is, it's not about judgment, not at all about judgment. Honoring each other, seeing each other, and seeing another point of view is very important. And that's the ethos that drive us. And we've yet to have a conversation where we end up with polar opposites. Usually people start seeing sides that they actually never thought they would accept or understand. It's absolutely amazing.
Yeah, but don't you think that that's one of the prescriptions for healing the division on the planet? Because if we listen to each other and we enter into dialogue, then there's no outside over there. It's like we're in the sphere. So I want to, yes, exactly. So yes. I want to know about this vision you have in 2025. Yes. You want to have a conference. Yes,
I do.
Talk to me about that.
In August 2025, I want to have a conference. The purpose of the conference is to create a platform for collaborations and networks. Now, because of the nature of my business, I always connect businesses. I literally recruit people to sit on people's boards, and we create advisory boards and set up structures like that. So the conference intention is to create a platform for networking. It'll be awesome. It'll be a week-long event. There will be safaris, there'll be golfing, and there'll be a backyard braai. We call it a braai, you call it a barbecue. So it's a
okay.
But what this conference will be is it's not going to be, we're not aiming for huge numbers. We want to keep it intimate. We want to bring in a sense of community in it. And we want to create lasting relationships between the people that we are inviting who are not South Africans and within also, you know, in the diaspora, but also, you know, beyond just South Africa itself, just within Africa as well. So we want to create this pot where you just have different nationalities and you're spending a week together and you're doing fun, interesting things. It feels like you're visiting your aunt kind of vibe, but still kept very, very, very professional. So
sounds fabulous. Okay. I want to know, tell people, how do they find you?
So I am on divineconversations.africa. So just divineconversations.africa. All the information is on our website. You go straight to divineconversations.africa. And if I'm sure, if you Google my name, there aren't a lot of Dibetes, so I still get away with quite a bit. So if you Google, I'm likely to come up tops, and purely because there aren't CD Dibetes, I don't know of any other yet that is Googleable. So
yes. For any of you who are just listening, it's C-I-N-D-Y and then capital D-I-B-E-T-E.
That's it.
That's great. Well, I want to... Before I ask you my last question, I want to ask you this. Mm. You're a woman in South Africa, which is South Africa has had a big history, including what you just spoke about with the women. Do you feel powerful and safe in this environment, or are you continuing and constantly re-anchoring that empowered state?
I think it's more of the latter because of, as we correctly say, yes, the history, but also the environment. I feel safe because I continuously re-anchor and put things around myself to make sure that I enjoy that safety and get that feeling of safety. It's an ongoing process. And again, as a woman, you know, there's just a lot of lies that we've believed as women. So there's that as well, that one has to scrape through to get to the truth of what actually is. So sometimes things look more scarier than what they actually are. So it is very important for me to educate myself, get the information and move from an informed point of view. And that helps me to anchor who I am and feel my safety.
I just love that and feel so grateful to be with you. I ask the same last question of every guest. This show is called Women Awakening. What do you think is the most important thing about women awakening at this moment on the planet?
I think the most important thing is really becoming closer and closer to the truth. I think as women, for the longest time, we really have believed the lie that we are less than. And that has just been at the core of most of the things that we see, which are unfortunately unpleasant, whether happening to women or through women or whichever way. So the awakening for me is really coming closer to the truth of who we actually are. And when I look at it in the larger scheme of things, I sometimes, if not more often, feel that we all kind of are victims of the same situation because there's this central lie that we're looking at from different perspectives. So women awakening is just coming to the truth of what actually is, you know? And when we get there, there's just so much peace there. There's the wholeness and a better, you know, life quality and experience of life as a woman, if we come to the truth of who we are, because no one is less than nobody.
Yes. Well, Thank you so much. You're just such a bright light and have such a strong center. Thank you so much for being here and bringing your wisdom. And I'm so excited to hear about 2025, you know, Divine Conversations.
Yes, we will definitely be sharing more and more as it unfolds. We're going to have the Divine Conversations on Business Awakening. That's basically, you know, the sub theme that we will have on there. I'm looking forward to it. And thank you so much for having me, Cynthia. Really appreciate it.
Okay, ladies, I say the same thing to you every week in different words. You are worthy. You are powerful. You are dynamic. You are unique. You are one of a kind. Therefore, your presence on this planet at this point in time is essential. Make no mistake about it. So whatever you have to do to anchor that truth within yourself and move away from that lie that Cindy talked about, that we're less than, whatever you have to do, do that, because the world is waiting for you. I love you, and I'm so excited to be with you, and I'll see you next time.